All right, now we're going to take a look at the IP version 4 packet. We took a look at the addressing. We took a look at layer 3 and what layer 3 looks like. Let's take a look at the packet and see what it looks like. Here's an IP version 4 header. The IP version 4 header has some sort of payload, or possibly not, and then it has the IP header. The IP header is about 20 bytes. There are some options that can be included into this, which would extend how big the IP header is, but that's not altogether common. So we don't need to worry too much about those options. And then we see that the payload is typically between 0 and 1,480 bytes. Although we can actually have packets that are much larger than that, and we'll see the reason why for that. But we know that there's some sort of maximum transmission unit that this is capable of handling. Most equipment is capable of handling. So we typically see a max payload of 1480 to make the whole thing typically around 1500 bytes. And so that's what a packet size is. And then one thing to note is that we've thrown around the terms frame and packet. Frame is generally associated more with a layer 2 as it's formed in layer 2. And a packet is the layer 3. And that's the packet is going to remain mostly consistent throughout this process of transmitting this data. So this is an IP version 4 packet right here. And let's get into the header and what is in the header. Now, ideally, I'd have the IP version 4 header spread across. I used to do it across the whiteboard and have it spread across this whole whiteboard, because what the way a computer will read this and send this data is in a stream of bits. So you'll have ones and zeros all in a stream, and it'll all be, in my mind, kind of horizontal as it's sending it across. What we have to do is we don't have space to do that here. So I'm going to go vertical with this. And what I'll explain this in a second, but what you'll see here typically is what's found like in textbooks, or if you're looking online, this is what you're going to see. And across the top is, I've got these in blocks of octets. So you'll see 4 octets that are across the top, or bytes. That's 1 byte. Or I actually got it marked down into bits right here. So you'll see the bit level right there and how these different components are breaking down into the bits. So here on the top row, we have what's representing byte 0 through 3. And the next one is byte 4 through 7. And the next one is byte 8 through 11. So we've just stacked this all on top of each other so we can see the whole thing as a whole. So this is the IP header. And let's get into it and look at the different components of an IP header. First up, we have the version. And the version, if you notice, it's taking up 4 bits. So there's 4 bits here. It has up to 16 possibilities, or 0 through 15 to represent it. The version is just what version of header this is. And so we're looking at an IP version 4 header. And so that way, when this comes into the equipment, this into the router is going to see that this is going to be an IP version 4 header, or if it was IP version 6, it would say an IP version 6 in here. And so then it knows how to handle this packet. If it is a IP version 4, then we would actually see specifically the bits 0100. Next up is the IHL, or the Internet Header Length. We see that there is 4 bits, so this could represent a number anywhere from 0 through 15. And what it represents is how big the header is. So it's going to represent what we're looking at right here, not the payload, but just the internet header. And so the internet header is going to include all of what we're seeing right here, but typically we don't have an option on here. And so typically it would just represent this right here. Now it's represented in how many 32 bits parts of this internet header there is. And so since there's 32 across here, to figure out the number that's supposed to go in this IHL, all we have to do is count how many lines there are. So we count the lines 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, that 5 is going to be what's represented in there, or it would be a 0101 that we'd see here in the internet header length. Since options aren't typically included in our packets, then typically what we'd see in an internet in the IP version 4 header is going to be a 0101. And so if there is more than that, if there's more, if it exists more lines that it's including, then that means we have some sort of options available. And so this will specify, hey, you got to look at those options. And lastly, we have the options field, the options right here. So this was to incorporate some options into IP version 4 to allow some additional functionality. Now, we don't see this commonly used. In fact, there's a lot of devices that it's been used for some nefarious purposes. So a lot of devices will actually, for security purposes, get rid of packets that have options that are incorporated into it. So we don't really see the options as being used all that much, which is once again why our IHL, which specifies our internet header length, will usually remain at 5, or that there's 5 lines that are part of this. And so it'll only communicate this first part, and the options generally are not within our packets. Next, we have the DSCP, or the Differentiated Service Code Point. The DSCP, that's just a fancy title to say what type of packet this is. What information is it hauling across this line? And so, this might be to flag or signal things like voice over IP, so that way it can prioritize this packet. In fact, this field used to be called the type of service, or TOS. And so, it specifies, once again, just what the payload is. And so that way the router or whatever equipment it's going across will know how to handle this packet. Next is the ECN, or what is known as the Explicit Congestion Notification. The ECN is just a way to send information from one point to another saying, hey, there's some congestion that's happening. And then the devices on each side can start shaping the traffic a little differently and start making some changes because there are some congestion. So this is just a way that some of the devices can communicate when there's congestion on the line. Then we have the total length. So we find the total length right here. We can see it's 2 octets or 2 bytes big. And so that is, it would be 16 bits. So if we take 10 to the 16th power, that equals 65,536 different possibilities. So essentially what this is this tells you what the total length of the packet is, header and the payload. And so header and the payload, the total length can be 65,536. Now, typically what we find is most equipment can't handle that large of a packet. So we have a maximum transmission unit that is much smaller than that. But IP version 4 packets are capable of handling bigger packets if the equipment is equipped to handle those bigger packets. But once again, what this is it's telling what is the total size of this packet. Then we have identification. This identification field is it's 16 bits long, and it can identify the packet. Now, it's primarily used if a packet needs to be fragmented and then reassembled on the other side. It's primarily used to identify which packets belong with each other, so that way they can be reassembled on the other side. So that's the identification. Next up, we have flags. The flags are little bits that we can turn to ones and zeros to flag whether something exists or something doesn't exist. In this particular case, these flags are associated with the identification and the fragment. Really, it has to deal with fragmenting, and so we can identify certain components of the fragment and just by turning these bits on or off. Then we have the fragment offset, and we can see by this that It is 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. We've got 13 bits that represent this. And what this just is that if something is fragmented, if one of these packets are fragmented, then this is how much offset from the first packet. Or in other words, it tells the machine on the other end how to reassemble fragmented packets. So next up is the time to live, or the TTL. A time to live on a packet is to prevent, if there is a routing loop, is to prevent this from continuing on forever. So what I mean by that is there are times when a packet is getting passed from piece of equipment to piece of equipment back to a piece of equipment. It's formed some sort of loop, or maybe even it's going between two pieces of equipment where it's being sent out and being sent right back. And that can happen because each one of your routers could think that the network that it's trying to send this information off to exists on the other side. And so it keeps sending this back and forth. Now, what the problem with that is you get enough of that traffic and it can cripple your network. It can bring it down to its knees. And so to eliminate any kind of packets that get stuck in this loop, there's this time to live. And the time to live, what will happen is every time it passes through a layer 3 piece of equipment, that time to live will get decremented by 1. And so eventually that time to live will come down to 0. And then that piece of equipment that is processing that will get rid of it. And that will no longer continue to exasperate the problem by creating that loop and having that packet live in that loop. Next up, we have the protocol. The protocol is defined with 8 bits or a byte. And that protocol just defines what's within the payload and what information is being transferred over. So that's the protocol. Next up, we have the header checksum. The header checksum is 16 bits long, and what it will do is when a machine will assemble this packet, it'll do a little algorithm to the header and create a hash out of it. And then so when it's sent across to another device, that device will then take a look at that header and it will go through the same algorithm and create a hash, and it'll compare those hashes. If the hashes are different, something was not calculated correctly. And so it will drop that packet because that packet, there's something wrong with the packet. And so the header checksum is a checksum that allows to make sure that the information is being sent across, that it's not getting corrupted along the way. Now, what's interesting about this is that we do change the header with this time to live. Every time it hits a new device, a new layer 3 device, it has to recalculate that time to live by decrementing it by 1. And so it has to recalculate the header checksum. So every stop along this layer 3 from network to network as it goes along, it's going to actually recalculate this header checksum along its path. Then, of course, what we do have is the source IP. The source IP, as we know, is 4 octets long, or it is 4 bytes. It is 32 bits long. And so we have the source IP address right here. And then we also have the destination IP address. The destination IP address, same. It's 4 bytes long, 32 bits. And so we have the source and destination IP address. And it takes that destination IP address, that layer 3 device, that layer 3 router is going to take that destination IP address and figure out where it needs to send it next. How do I send this on to its next location? Okay, that concludes IP version 4 packets. You can see that there's quite a bit to the involvement of what these packets have, but each one of those informations plays a part in getting this packet from one location to the next. Thanks again for watching my video. If you liked it, could you hit that like button?